Next on Enviro Close Up, the Mothers Project. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Karl Grossman. With me is Angela Monti Fox, and she's the founder of the Mothers Project. Welcome, Angela.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
Angela, what is the Mothers Project?
The Mothers Project is a mom-powered organization. It's a group that originally started actually with the Mother's Letter to Michelle Obama, which we wrote in 2012. So we're a very young organization, but we've done a lot of outreach. And we really feel that it's the mother's voice that's very important because it's a powerful voice. We're here to advocate for children who can't advocate for themselves in terms of environmental issues, in terms of the fossil fuel industry, the nuclear industry. And actually, it started quite by accident. When we wrote the letter to the mother, to Michelle Obama, we had a very small group. It was less than 200 people, and we raised about $50,000 in order to publish that letter in the New York Times, a full-page ad on Mother's Day weekend. And a lot of people ask me, well, did you ever get an answer from Michelle on that letter? And I say, yes, but not from Michelle. The answer was from the 1,000 people that signed on to our website. Of course, we had put up a website for that letter. We had 1,000 sign-ons the very next few hours and the next day and through that week. So it told me that there was a need for the mother's voice. And since that time, we've gotten several unofficial affiliates, but we use our logo and our Facebook page, and we have one in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Colorado, which is extremely important in terms of the fossil fuel industry and the drilling there. And the Louisiana Bayou, which I was introduced to two of the tribes there that have been really devastated by not only Katrina, but the BP oil spill. We're doing work in those areas.
The activity in Louisiana that you're involved with?
Well, the Mothers Project became involved with that through an organization called Plenty International that have been doing relief work for many years, since the 1970s. And they became involved with two tribes that are in the Louisiana Bayou. One, which is on an island called Ile de Jean Charles, which is right off the tip of Louisiana. The other one's called the Pointe-Chen tribe. And basically what has happened, they've been devastated by the BP oil spill and by the storms. The drilling itself that has taken place on the island has created so many canals where the ocean then could come in. It's ruined their vegetation. It's ruined their fishing. They make their living through the ocean and through planting and through hunting. So basically, that tribe is really gone or has to leave. And one of the things that we became involved with every year is to bring Christmas to the children in the bayou. And we also became involved with the council meetings there, where they want very much to be able to preserve their medicinal herbs. So that's one of the projects that we're very involved in, and bringing solar energy there to do that.
The Mothers Project, the naming of the Mothers Project, any connection with the Manhattan Project?
Well, it's interesting that you ask it. You know, some people say, why the Mothers Project? And actually, when we looked it up, there is another Mothers Project. And the people working with me said, why don't you change the name? And I said, no, it has to be that. Because I was very interested in the idea that when the Manhattan Project was formed, there was political will to put the money behind that entity to create such a fantastic, and ultimately destructive event, the atomic bomb. And it showed me that when a government and, the universe, whatever around, is interested in putting money and the politics are right, anything could be done. And of course, nuclear energy was just a sidestep to the real issue, which was the bomb, which is an absolutely amazing event that took place in that short a period of time.
And a horrendous event, nuclear weapons, and then the extension of
nuclear energy, right, which looked like a good thing, and some people today still think it's a good thing.
Well, people are often mistaken. What was the thrust of that letter to Michelle Obama?
The thrust of the letter was because at the time, she wanted to make it her mark that the health of children was an issue. She wanted that to be her mark. And that seemed like a very simple thing, you know, to talk about childhood diabetes, talk about nutrition, to talk about exercise. And so we addressed her with all the information we had at the time, which now has quadrupled on the science of what actually happens to children who are exposed to chemicals, what happens to their brains, the issue of critical periods where embryonic development is disturbed. And we wanted her to know that she could embrace this. I mean, it was mistaken. It was the first the first 4 years of the administration. And of course, we were devastated when Obama came out with his energy plan and included natural gas, and still are devastated. But that was what we want. And we ended the letter with, could she be our 21st century Eleanor Roosevelt? Mm. Looking at the rights that the rights organizations that Eleanor Roosevelt put forth, and it was established by the United Nations. So it seemed like the right thing to do. It didn't go anywhere, but we still grew from that. We pursued this. And I think some of our goals are still yet to be met. I mean, we have no funding. We need funding in order for things to happen. But we're very interested in engaging with mothers who know the issues and those who don't know the issues to help educate them.
And you never got even a form letter from the White House.
No, and in
never
fact,
got a response.
In fact, the letter came about because the year before, when the first Gasland movie came out, a couple of my friends said, let's write to Michelle Obama. So they said, you write, you're the mother. So of course I wrote a wonderful letter, and we sent it with a copy of Gasland, the first Gasland. And in fact, one of the women whose husbands had a connection, they thought, to someone who played basketball with Obama, with Barack. So we sent it by mail, we sent it special delivery, and we sent it with a copy, of course, the Gasland film, with this guy who supposedly was going to hand it to him. And it was disappointing. We never got a response. And so the next year, Mother's Day came around. They said, okay, it was around January or February. My son was having an event at Riverside Church, at St. John the Divine. And I said to him, I want to announce this. We're going to do a public letter to Michelle Obama. And of course, he announced it and brought me up on the stage and announced it. And it got a very resounding response. People were very interested in the idea of writing to her. So that's really how the whole thing started.
And you speak of being the mother here and your son and Gasland. Let's put that together. You're the mother of Josh Fox, who created, in my view, just two landmarks in investigative reporting. The documentary Gasland 1, now it's called 1. Originally it was just Gasland, because he's done this just terrific. I mean, I wondered how he would be able to follow up Gasland with a second part, but somehow he was able to pull it off. Gasland 2, just landmarks again I teach investigative reporting, landmarks in the field of investigative reporting, and it involves a lot of Josh Fox's history and your history and Josh's father's history, your husband's history. Tell us the story. Here you have this little house in Pennsylvania, and
I just want to backtrack for a second and say that it's hard for me to say he's the father of this movement because he's a young guy.
The
anti-fracking. He really is. There really was no anti-fracking movie before the Gasland movie, and you have to give him that. That movie, and also because it was nominated for an Academy Award, got the note, and other awards, the Environmental Media Award, etc. And an Emmy as well. It got the notoriety it needed. But it started really with getting that letter, as the story is told in Gasland, getting that letter at the house, because Josh, that's his residence now, it's really where he lives. got that letter in the mail, and he and his dad went over it, looked at it. What does this mean? You know, the idea it's going to be just a little bit of a fire hydrant. But he, you know,
the letters, they
imagined it would just be like a fire hydrant on your property.
Yeah, but the letter was...
offering him, I think, $5,000 an acre. It came to $100,000 to put a well on his property.
A fracking well on his
property. Right. And so he got in his car and with some money from some people who threw money at him from that town, Damascus citizens, and his camera, went on the road, gave me a heartache because he... A heart attack, I should say, every time, because he was by himself traveling across the United States, him and his camera. And I thought he was taking a crew. I remember him saying that to him. Are you gonna, you're not going to be alone, are you? And I didn't get a real answer, but he was alone, and he made this film.
And he never made a film before, did he?
He made one other film. It was called Memorial Day. It was about the Iraq War, and it didn't really go very far.
Okay.
It did show at IFC, but it didn't go very far.
Okay.
This was his second film. He's basically a theater director. And but he can tell a story, so.
Oh, he tells the story very well. I mean, I think the images in Gasland 1 of people turning on their tap and taking a cigarette lighter or a match to the tap water and it exploding in flames. I mean, here, there, all over the United States where fracking is done. What an image.
Well,
what a statement.
That was something that I think was a total surprise. And originally, when we first saw the first... you know, videos from what he was collecting, it was quite amazing. In fact, I had some local meetings with some of the local legislators and showed those pictures. This was the very beginning. There was no anti-fracking movement, but the visual was so potent because water doesn't catch on fire. And so just that visual alone was what brought the story home. And in the second film, I think he had some amazing footage of the Louisiana, the bayou, the Louisiana issue with the BP oil spill, where he came very close and could film the coaxit and the oil on the surface there. And it moved it into being able to talk about our democracy. So that's the message of the second film.
Well, also in the second film, let me note from my perspective what Josh was able to do was extend and expand. The first film, Gasland, is really about the United States and fracking here. But wow, the second film goes to Australia. I mean, he goes all over the world and I think so importantly documents how these American oil and gas companies have been pushing hydraulic fracking now all over the world. And in fact, this is also in Gasland too, how the plan is to take the gas from fracking here in America and export it. So
And so we become, you know, like a third world country. I mean, when you look at how many people, and this is the issue of the Mother's Project, that how many people are now living so close to wells in America that the research that is emerging, I mean, what we put in that initial letter is nothing to what we have now. The research that is emerging that's showing the devastation that's occurring in pregnancy, premature birth, low birth weight, actual birth defects that are occurring. There's a new study coming out of Colorado now, which is showing the effect of living very close to the wells, the endocrine disruption exchange, TEDx, is very important organization that's putting together all the research. And also the Center for Environmental Health. They have volumes now of research that's showing the damage that's being done, not just to the generation that's being birthed now, to the embryo and the womb now, but to the next generation, because you're damaging the actual structure of the DNA. So you can see that the child that's going to be born, should it survive, is also going to be influenced by this environmental impact. You know, for years we've been looking at what is the cause of all this autism? What's the problem here that we have so much ADHD, attention deficit disorder in schools? And as a clinician, it's always been, you know, I studied child development. It's always been an issue of mine. And so now we're looking at the real research that's saying this is the cause. You can start with a good egg and a good sperm, match it together, and you can have a good beginning, a good zygote forming, a healthy zygote, a healthy embryo. And the environmental impact of the chemicals, including fracking chemicals and all the other chemicals that we already had, will influence that development in critical stages so that you will have this outcome. So you started with good genetics, and even though you have these good genetics, and they're talking about this as being a pandemic, 25% of the population, the global population, is affected by this environmental impact. And so then here you have the reason why we have this tremendous increase in autistic children, this tremendous increase in attention deficit disorder, the brain being influenced. There's one research I read recently in the papers to come out soon. It's called Only One Chance, and it's about the development of the brain. So you only have one chance when that brain is developing. And it becomes distorted, it becomes influenced by the environment in such a way that there's no way to repair that.
Okay, Angela, for viewers who might not be familiar with the details on fracking, or the formal name is hydraulic fracturing, and it's really something new that's come along. In the 1980s, the U.S. Department of Energy, our government, in fact, developed this system of, they had vertical fracking, but hydraulic fracturing of shale deposits to get the gas out. I mean, this is a kind of a new thing, but to do this hydraulic fracturing, what's used, 600 chemicals, and these companies won't tell you what, as Josh Fox, your son, stresses in Gasland 1 and 2, the companies want to tell us what kind of chemicals they're using. And enormous amounts of water, and some of the fracking is going on, a lot of it, in areas with very little water. Water supplies now, again, Josh documents this, all over the country, indeed now with fracturing of shale happening all over the world, water is not drinkable, it's not potable because of fracking. So important. And the other element too here, which Josh gets into, is some of the shale deposits have radium in them, have radioactive material in them, which gets out. And so that exacerbates Rachel Carson years ago in Silent Spring wrote about how chemical contaminants and radioactive contaminants, 2 and 2, don't add up to 4. There's a synergistic impact, and the two of them together make things even worse. Let me answer this question. What your son has exposed, revealed, has met with such a counterattack. I mean, you can't turn on commercial television right in the United States today without, there's a blonde lady who appears with these very slick advertisements about energy independence and the importance of fracking. There's so much pressure, counter pressure, because of what Josh has done, supporting fracking. You think that the war against fracking, the fight against fracking, can and will be won?
I think it will be won, because we have grown. If you look at the last 4 years, we have grown incredibly. As a movement, it has grown. Even to the point when you talk about those advertisements, I don't know if you've noticed, but in a few of them in the background, there's an anti-fracking sign. So they are recognizing that there's an anti-fracking movement. I think, you know, the issue is that there has to be enough of a groundswell for this to happen. And little by little, there are issues that are coming up that we can actually start to chip away. Like, for instance, right now in New York, where there's two things that are going on in New York. In New York State, we have a de facto moratorium against fracking, but we could be receiving all the frack waste and the wastewater into our plants and on our roads. And so there's legislation both on the state and the local level to prohibit that, because the community, the New Yorkers are smart. They're thinking about, oh, this is happening. All these pipes that are going on, there's a lot of opposition to them. Compression stations is opposition to. And the Mothers Project has been involved in a number of them, in Minisink, in New Jersey, you know, supporting those people who are opposing it. And in New York City, there's been the issue that the gas we're going to be getting, which you mentioned before, the radioactivity, is very high in radon because it's going to be coming from a very close distance instead of the further distance where we usually got it. The radon does not have an opportunity to decay. It's a scientific fact. We're going to be getting from wells that are way off the charts in terms of the rate of radon. And so what we've looked at to our legislators to say, no, we have to stop this. The Mothers Project has written to Con Edison. We've had them on the carpet when they've appeared at various community board meetings. You cannot, you know, in all conscience, think you're going to deliver this gas to us and we're not going to say anything about it. So there's movement. I mean, it may not be the kind of movement you're talking about, which is enough to really turn us over to the sun and the wind and whatever, but it will happen. I think it will happen.
We're speaking to Angela Monti Fox. She is the founder of the Mothers Project. And on the positive side of things, one of the things, the main thing that the Mothers Project stresses is that you don't need the toxic gas produced by fracking. You don't need various fossil fuels that lend themselves to global warming. You don't need nuclear power. As you say, we're not going to run out of sunshine and wind anytime soon. In fact, safe, clean, renewable energy, energy we can live with, is here today if we make use of it.
Well, it's here if there were enough money and political will to put that in place. In fact, my son has started this nonprofit organization called the Solutions Project in conjunction with some of the scientists from Stanford who have laid out the program by which we would have solar energy and wind and hydro, a combination of which would give us the solutions that we needed in terms of sustainable energy. What the program is really basically going to be done on a community level. It's a combination, I gather, of you know, theater work, artwork, which will produce from that audience interaction with these productions some solutions that will be on a community-based level. Like when it's talked about, it's not talked about what you can do in your own community. And I think this is what is going to happen. It'll be brought about in a community way, section by section, so that overall the influence of sustainable energy will be brought.
From the Mothers Project now to the Solutions Project. Now with other mothers around the country, around the nation, like if you go to the website of the Mothers Project, there's an invite to join with us, to work with us. Explain how people out there could connect to the Mothers Project, link up their organizations to the Mothers Project?
We want them to connect at whether they already have existing mothers organizations, and there are many, or as individuals to get involved with the different projects that we're working on. For instance, if I talk about the New Jersey group, the Mothers Project in New Jersey, they're very active in the legislation on the frack waste, you know, not bringing that in, the legislation that would stop the compression stations in communities where there are housing. In the Bayou, we're working with two tribes on their, we have a very special project there, which also needs some volunteers. We're looking to bring about freestanding solar-powered garden that would enable them to produce their healing herbs, which they have been losing, their medicinal healing herbs. They have been losing them because of the BP oil spill and the many years of drilling that have created an influx of saline, of salt water into the land. So many of the places where they grow these herbs, they can no longer grow them. So this is a very different type of a project. But it's a very important one because it would be a process by which they would not only be able to grow the herbs, but transmit the information to the younger generation.
Angela, you're trained as a psychotherapist.
Right.
I just wonder now, after years of political and environmental activism. How nuts do you think, or is it just greed, or both, those pushing society in these toxic directions are?
Well, if you're talking about the companies, it is greed, it is money. But people are very much wanting to keep their own job, you know? So if they're part of a company, I think one of the issues that goes on is denial, you know, which is part of everybody's psychological makeup. They don't really want to take in the information that exists about the damage that they're doing. And if they did, they would have to, you know, really confront their own conscience. It's like the tobacco industry. Look at how they perpetrated the benefits of tobacco when you had doctors smoking cigarettes and things like that because they wanted to show you that it was healthy. Didn't they really know it wasn't healthy? They did really know it wasn't healthy. But in that corporate mentality, you have all of these people whose entire livelihood, their careers and everything is, they bought the, what's the saying, they've drank the Kool-Aid. So they believe that they can do it, either they can do it safely or whatever the story is, they believe they're on the right side, that we need this energy, that they're saving the world. You know, it's a very complex thing to penetrate that and get them to see that they're not, that they're really hurting a great deal of the population and they're really hurting the environment and mostly they're hurting the generations to come. This is a very hard pill to swallow. So, I mean, you know, it does border on, maybe they are a little crazy, you know, it does.
And asking us to jump into their bus and go over the cliff. Angela, the website of the Mothers Project is what?
It's themothersproject.org.
Themothersproject.org. And again, you're looking for people to link with you in in this fight against bad energy technologies, fracking and nuclear power and so forth, and to push for safe, clean, renewable energy.
Yeah, we're really looking for them to understand the impact on, this is why we're engaged with mothers, the impact on children, the impact on the next generation, the impact on an up-and-coming baby you want to have. It's very, very important that they recognize, just the way they would watch their diet when they become pregnant, they have to recognize the dangers that are around them, and they have to be able to become active and do something about it.
Yes, absolutely. Our guest has been Angela Monti Fox. She's the founder of the Mothers Project, a very important organization involved in a very important crusade, fighting against toxic, poisonous energy sources, fracking and nuclear power, and battling for safe, clean, renewable energy. Thanks for your work, Angela. Thanks for everybody involved in the Mothers Project. And thank you for watching. This has been Enviro Close-Up. I'm Karl Grossman. To learn more about the Enviro Close-Up series, just visit us at www.envirovideo.com.